Good morning. This is the compensation class for, I'm going to call it, for FMX210 Digital Media, the 8 a.m. class due to Hurricane Idalia has been canceled and classes begin at noon, which is fine for the afternoon class, but not so good for the morning class. So I'm preparing you this video so that you are not behind the other class, and that next week we will be able to all proceed together into the subject of this class. All right, so today, normally in the first class, I would go around the class and ask everybody about their majors and find out what the class student body is made up of, which helps me to speak to different groups like ad PR or film and address some of the specifics of their majors. So, since we can't do that, I'm going to start out by introducing myself. I am Chip Neville, and you may call me Professor Neville or Mr. Neville or Chip. I really am pretty informal in my interaction with students. You don't have to be terribly formal with me. I'm an adjunct professor. I have been teaching for almost 30 years, and prior to that, I was an art director, artist, musician. Part of the reason that I'm in a film department is that my undergraduate degree is in music, composition, and that, my primary instrument was classical guitar, but as a composer, you had to learn, how to be piano and sang in every vocal ensemble I could get into, including Glee Club. And which I, back then didn't mean what it means now. Back then, Glee Club was extremely nerdy. Now it's like kind of cool after the TV show and movies and stuff. Play bass and guitar. But as it pertains to this class, the most pertinent thing is I have a master's degree in visual art. When you go to my webpage, chipneville.com, you can read my short bio and learn all about me. I have an artist statement and examples at the bottom of each old HTML webpage. Excuse me, you can see it's 2016 here and that I haven't updated this in a very long time. And so the HTML is not wrapping right. If you're looking on a phone or anything else, I'm not sure how it's going to display, but even here on a desktop browser, I'm getting a bad rap on the top part. So I got to update my CSS, my Adobe CSS part of the web page. Down at the bottom here, I have some links to social media. I really don't do social media. I'm on YouTube. I have videos on YouTube. And here's my education. You can click on my ecological advocacy. Do a lot of art that's involved with the environment and concerns of nature. And I've been chronicling it and living in this area for a long time. So there's a lot of that there. So that's my homepage. There's a tab for all the major things I do. I'm kind of a man who wears many hats, you'll see. So here, you can see that under visual art, I've got a lot of examples of what a visual artist does. A visual artist does many things. They're not bound by medium, so it's different. Visual artist is different than saying painter or sculptor, in that visual artists embrace all the mediums and create things that are visual, whether they be two-dimensional or three-dimensional or both. Here's some acrylic abstracts that I do. I'm very have a lot of fun making woodcuts and linoleum blocks. I draw a lot in Adobe Illustrator. This example here is we were tasked with being drawing a self-portrait of ourselves as a anime character. So you see me there with my guitar chopping up a giant Cthulhu-like creature. Looks more like an octopus, giant octopus. But anyway. Photography. I'm probably really a photographer. I don't actually call myself that because I don't know. I never made much money at it, but I've actually had to work as a photographer this for the state of Florida and ran a wet dark room and all that kind of stuff back in the day. But nowadays I use photography purely creatively, as you see here, or as documenting. So I document all the stuff I do. So if I'm creating artwork, or you can see here's a montage of me documenting my band under the music tab. You can see I've got about a couple of different creative modes. I do guitars, digital audio, or singer-songwriter. I basically play in three kinds of musical settings. I either play in my Echo Pulse, which is a contemporary to a classic rock cover band, and we play, you know, we play some Black Keys, and we play some Kings of Leon and some newer stuff, and we play some Hendrix and Talking Heads, some older stuff. I also played previously in a band that's no longer together with a colleague of mine, Dr. Gregory Lassar, who used to teach at University of Tampa. And we had a electronic music, an electronic music duo where we did what's known as sound experimentation. So he had a synthesizer and I had a guitar. I tried my very best not to play notes and melodies and chords, but really expand myself into pure abstraction. And you can see a number of those examples on my on my YouTube page. Oh no, I'm missing a digital audio thing here. Digital audio, I mean, what can I say? Film, internet, anything is digital. Everything is digital audio now. I'm not sure why it's a separate category. Also, a lot of animation in my background. Skunk Ape here is really in a state of disrepair and is actually getting ready to have a complete revamp. This shouldn't really even be there, but you can watch it and see what the animation looks like. The audio, however, is about to insanely change. And what's in there was just a marker so I could get it up, so I could, you know, people could, there were some people who wanted to see it, you know, and so I was like, I'm like, not ready yet. And they were like, put it up anyway. And so I kind of did. It's not, it's just sitting there right now, but it's about to get a big makeover. I had written an album that I'm going to share with you the artwork for a little bit later, but part of what's on that album is this remake of this Ballad of Skunk Ape song I did in 2005 for part of my master's program. You can see a pencil test here and a final art. I also did a bunch of like web animation in the early 2000s. I had like three little funky series. I had Tale from Suburbia, Epoch, and Epoch was about dinosaurs and cavemen. Tales from Suburbia was about how weird it is to live in suburbia. And you know, I would just make several episodes under each category. It kind of never went anywhere because that was done in Adobe Flash, and Adobe Flash was changing really quickly and was about to be taken over by Adobe and this whole thing. So I ended up dropping that technology and going with After Effects just to kind of finish the thought. Like Adobe Flash was not syncing the audio reliably, so I ended up making all my animations like Skunk Ape there in Adobe After Effects, where I could rely on the audio and the video to stay synchronized. I also do installation work. I have a huge background in carpentry. I used to weave, believe it or not, all through my St. Petersburg College associate's degree. I worked at a place called Rattan Crafters, and I wove chairbacks day in and day out. I mean, rattan chairbacks, weaving. It was awesome. I loved doing that because it was muscle memory, and it was almost like meditating after a while. You just do some. I had to do like 400 chairs. It took forever. And we did tables and ottomans and all the other stuff. I also built custom musical flight cases, a place called Viking Cases. I worked at Gulf Star Yacht. So I ended up with all this wood skill, not to mention I grew up in a military family. And when you grow up in a military family, you don't get people to do stuff for you. You do stuff. You figure it out. You learn the skills necessary and you do it. So from electronics in my early years, you know, I asked for AM and FM radio and got this thing called a Heath kit. You had to build yourself. It was very typical of how my family went. So I had a lot of mechanical skills and I started putting it into my art. So you can see here the retroscope, which is a like deco distorted TV from the 1950s. I was basing the design somewhat on a Chris Hillerman animation called Rocco's Modern Life. If you love SpongeBob, boy, you should really know who Rocco is. This is plank. And again, with cartoons, if I call this face on a board plank, all you Gen Z people should go, "You mean like Ed, Ed, and Eddie?" And I would go, "Bingo." Yeah, this is my version of plank, except for it's made out of, it's kind of dark. It's made out of dead animal parts. Those are baby squirrel skulls for the eyes and a bird's sternum for the nose. It's, if you look closely, it's weird. It's on a nice piece of red oak and has brass fittings. I made it out of a ceiling fan light. Appropriation art. I did this thing called the animatotropescope, which is a cross between a sort of a coffin and a pre-cinema Victorian animation device. It's hard to explain. You can kind of look into that if you want to. The Luminous Peninsular Pyramid, one of my favorite things I ever made. It sang and glowed and lit up. It's basically there was a video camera inside of it projecting onto a board of broken glass, which was aimed back up into this shape that looked like a pyramid, and it sang and glowed. It was quite impressive. And then there's the refracticator, which I'm well known for amongst people I know, because I did a whole performance art thing with this. This is sort of a H.G. Wells sort of turn of the 19th century time machine kind of a deal, except for it would take a video and again shoot it into a plate full of broken mirrors or aimed mirrors that would then refract it back out. And I had a character that went to that was sort of a huckster prophet, the refracticator, dressed up in this fez and this fancy outfit with epaulets that was so fun to make. We made costumes, we made dialogue, we made this object. Basically got me through my graduate program on that. I like I said, I do all kinds of things. This is, I designed this dock in my backyard, which still stands today. It's been up for about 20 years, and I'm very proud of that design because it survived Hurricane Idalia, went underwater, still hung in there. Here you can see process on some of the artwork that I made up there. This is the animatotropescope and the refracticator and the retroscope. I like having fun with those names. So that's insulation. And of course, you know, I'm an educator. Wait, brain coral, get it? Brain coral, so you can find out if you're interested in what I feel about education and what I'm talking about. And so I've taught all ages, primary, secondary, and college, music, art. I've taught a lot of different things. So you can definitely, find out about my view of each. Now, on each one of these web pages down at the bottom here at Visual Art, I want to make sure you understand there's some recommended reading down there. And these books are really good. Ways of Seeing by John Berger, Camera Lucida by Roland Barthes. These are graduate level books that I think everybody should get something on out of under music, what to listen to from music and Aaron Copland, John Cage, Audio and Media by Stanley R. Alton. You should buy that book. Everyone should buy that book. Under animation, you know, we've got my favorites, William Kendridge, Preston Blair, Richard Williams, Kit Laybourne, Paul Wells. So go check that all out. Okay. So that's a little bit about me. I'm going to go ahead and move on to the syllabus now. Our syllabus is under the 01. I'm not going to go over this syllabus in in detail. I'm not going to read it back to you, but I am going to just sort of go over the objectives, which is proficiency with standard digital tools such as Illustrator and Photoshop. Do not ask me if you can use GIMP or any of those other free softwares. The answer is no. You got to use Photoshop and Illustrator. Nobody's going to hire you because you know Audacity. I mean, it's a free software. It's wonderful, but nobody's hiring for that. So you got to learn Audition or Pro Tools or Logic or Ableton, any of the ones besides the really cheap free ones. And cheap free ones are good. You can do work with those, but you shouldn't like base your portfolio and your resume on knowing them, because most people are like, well, yeah, I got that too. We're going to understand the nature of digital creation utilizing simple code, evidence the logic behind visual creation. We're not really going to be using code, but everything we do uses code. We're going to comprehend the difference between vector-based and pixel-based imaging. We're going to understand the importance of image optimization for online delivery as print delivery, usage of compression types and their purposes. You really got to get your stuff out there so it looks good. We're going to develop an understanding of the evolution of currently used industry accepted tools, especially the Adobe Creative Suite, as well as alternatives. Alternatives, are there? In class, as we go on, I'm going to say some very disparaging things about Adobe. I think they're a major monopoly, far worse than Microsoft or Apple, any of those, far worse, because it really puts a stranglehold on a single community, which is the arts community. Now, there have always been alternatives like Corel. And as a longtime knower and user of Corel all the way back to the 80s, let me just say that at least I haven't seen it recently, but it sucked back then. It was just not as easy to use. It would do the same job, but it was by much more cumbersome tools. So Adobe ended up having Photoshop, which is how Adobe started. And then Adobe started buying up other programs. It bought up Aldus, which made PageMaker, which became InDesign. It bought up Macromedia, which had Director, Flash, and Freehand. Freehand was their vector drawing tool that was destroyed in favor of Illustrator. Aldus PageMaker became InDesign. Flash became Animate and then was split up between Animate and Character Animator. So you can see that Adobe is like a big conglomerate that's sucking up all these great softwares and making them their own. And that's kind of why when you look at Adobe, sometimes you go, how come in Photoshop they call it Sheer and you go to Illustrator and they call it Skew? Or is it the other way around? I always get mixed up. It means the same thing. But you'll see, why does this software do this when this, why don't they all do it the same way? And it's because they started out as different programs. You're going to understand the nature of animation and video as sequence of stills and a manipulation of time. Create an online and printed portfolio from pieces created throughout the semester. Throughout the semester, it's super important, and you should all know this, that you're going to create a blog and that you're going to post your work from this class to a public blog. Working close with Santiago Echeverria, and he's telling me, man, they all have to do that, and they all know it, and they got to do it. You got to post your work. And for that, I would like to say that the audience completes the work. So the viewer completes the work. It doesn't matter, I guess there's times where you do artwork as a personal restorative or healing gesture, but in the general world, when you create art, it is completed when it is seen. So understand the nature of audio video sequence throughout the semester. Importance of digital journaling and self-assessment. That's the whole blog thing. We're going to make sure that you can, when you complete this course, you understand how computer graphics are created. You probably already do anyway. Create the vector graphics using vector editing tools such as Illustrator, pixel-based imaging using Photoshop, frame by frame animation and animate. Digital portfolio is the ending thing. Hey, in my class, we're going to do a PDF in InDesign, and I'm going to throw you into a little Adobe XD, which is a really wonderful web phone prototyping software that's super easy to use. I can, once you've been through the half of this class, I can explain XD to you, I promise you, in like 5 minutes. It's so easy and so gratifying because you make a interactive tool with it. It's wonderful. You're going to be required to have a flash drive or portable hard drive. You're going to need something that you directly save something to. Why can't you use the cloud? Well, if you use the cloud, you may, there could be internet outage and then you wouldn't be able to save your work. You're like, well, I'll save it to the local computer. And you know that those computers probably, I'm not sure about University of Tampa, but most places when you restart the computer, it clears the cache. It clears the saves. So I'm not sure what the policy at UT is, but you should always have your own storage, if whether it be a, you know, nowadays I would say a, you know, 64 gigabyte little flash drive, 32 gig work. Or one of those little flat spinny up flash drives or an SSD drive, whatever you've got. You're going to need a computer that can run Adobe Creative Suite. So the issue with Adobe Creative Suite is you're going to need 8 gigabyte of RAM to run Adobe software. I think I have a link to that in the next section here. You are going to need a computer that can run that. As far as process, it's a RAM issue. As far as the processor speed goes, I would say, you know, we live in an age where the average off-the-shelf computer would send you to Mars and back. So I don't think that's really where the problem is as much as the RAM and the storage space. So if you bought that cheapo MacBook Pro and you only got 128 gigabyte of RAM, ooh. Or I mean, hard drive space, because this happened to someone I know. They bought the small hard drive and then they couldn't put all the software on it. So make sure you got a big hard drive for your laptop. Make sure it's got 8 gigabyte of RAM and it should be a fast one. I'm going to use bunny ears. It doesn't need to be the fastest one, but it should have a modern processor that can, you know, probably dual core minimum, I would guess. Processing speeds change. If you have a Mac, it's all about M2s. I'm not going to go into it because it's constantly changing, but there are some answers you can get at Adobe that will tell you what the computer requirements are. Again, I'm going to keep talking about how you need to do your own research. So you guys are going to have to get on Adobe and answer your question. Don't ask me because I'm going to go, oh, well, shit, I haven't been to the Adobe site in forever. I'd have to go on there and find it for you. And how would I do that? I would do it the same way you should do it. So just get on there and Google it or, whoops, I said that word. We'll talk about that later. Recommended materials. A Wacom tablet, iPad, Android with an Apple Pen or equivalent as an external monitor drawing tablet. You should have a drawing tablet, I think. Mine is somewhere around here. I'm not using it right now. I have a screen tablet that I prefer, a Huey on. It's kind of an old one, but I'd rather draw on the screen than on a tablet. I used a tablet for years as a mouse. I didn't use a mouse for probably a decade because I just used a pen. It felt more natural to me, even though that I think the Apple mouse, which is really skinny and flat, is probably the most ergonomic thing for the back of your wrist that I know of. So get yourself a tablet. Don't tell me that because you don't have a tablet, you can't do your projects. A mouse will do it. It just won't do it as well. So get a pad so you can have pressure sensitivity. That's why. Also, the iPad or Huey on graphics tablet you draw on, it's just better because you see what you're drawing. You're not drawing over here and looking over there, which is a little bit of a brain disconnect. It can be done. I do it all the time, but it's better if you're looking right at it. It's more comfortable. Course surveys at the end of the class, please make sure to fill out all that kind of stuff. You are going to need to get electronic cage, CISO, what's the word? Registration. I was gonna say membership, but it's not like you just have to register. We'll talk about that next class. It's in the CAS building. You can go there, you can register for a CISO, and then you can check out a Wacom tablet before you buy one. You know, before I bought any technology nowadays, I would really like to use one first before I purchase it. So everybody, I know in Santiago's class, he's like, you gotta buy one. I'm like, man, if you can check one out, that's really great. If you have good resources and you can buy one, that's great too. But I would definitely try one, no matter whether you have money or not, before you buy it, because nobody who has money likes to waste money. Or is that true? I don't know. Unexcused absences in late assignments. Actually, I need to change that. I have a different course room policies. The one thing about these, please disregard. I need to get that out of there. I didn't realize that got pasted in. This is, I was given this class like with 2 weeks' notice. So, one of the things we're gonna have to talk about is I'm gonna be catching up. So, a lot of the course content isn't gonna come out for a couple weeks until I get everything in place. Everything's kind of in place, but I gotta fill in all the different things. So the core the syllabus could change, especially deadlines. I already had to change a deadline from the 3rd to the 11th because of the hurricane. So it's that changing of things as we go along is already going on. As you go down through here, you find the ADA, the Title IX, exposure to COVID, campus closures, academic integrity, attendance policy. That's again going to be overridden by what I'm going to talk to you about in a minute. Disruption. Oh, yeah. Really? Do I have to talk to you about disrupting the classroom? I don't think I do. Code of conduct and, you know, don't come in if you're sick. Here's a brief class schedule. We're going to start out with vector art, and we're going to have four projects in that unit. We're going to have three projects in the pixel unit. We're going to have two projects in a time-based unit. We're going to have two projects, really the same thing in two different softwares, in the publish. And then there's participation, which I am developing right now. So, like I said, you know, I got this class very recently, so I'm kind of scrambling to keep up with it. So, if you have any questions about any of this syllabus stuff, please make sure you contact me. Do notice that the section I'm making up for right now is section 10, which was 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. Tuesday and Thursday in CAS Building 134, my favorite, looking right out over the river. And from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., I get a class in the, I guess that's the Furman. I've never been over there. Super excited to go see that classroom. So anyway, which I will this afternoon. Okay, back to files. Whoops, I'm sorry, back to my course. My classroom policies document supersedes whatever's in the that we just went over in the syllabus. My classroom policies are these, and they are as follows. If you're on time, you're late. I said before, I come from a military family, and if you're on time, if you walk in at 8 a.m., you are late because it's going to take you at least 5 minutes to put your stuff down, get your chair, talk to your neighbor, turn on your computer, wait for it to come up, log in, get your thing, got your file, da-da-da, open the software. It's probably 10 minutes. So the correct time to arrive is about 5 to 10 minutes early, and I'll always be there at least that, if not a quarter till or 20 till. Or really, I try and get there a half an hour till, but like I said, I'm commuting, so I can't exactly guarantee when I'll exactly walk in the door. But it's always going to be early if I can help it. The attendance is mandatory. Okay, but to be reasonable, I mean, just like today's a perfect example, up to three cl I'm not counting today as against your absences, but you can miss up to three classes. Let's call it personal time off. Your car died, your dog lied, you slept through the alarm, there was a celestial event like a blue moon. It doesn't matter. You owe me a notification before, at least after the fact, for it to be PTO. You can't just blow it off without a word. I mean, people who just don't show up and then never say anything, dude, that's not professional. That's not okay. You'd be fired in a job for that. So don't do it to me. You'll be subject to a grade reduction after three classes. It depends on how many classes you miss after that. I mean, I have people who just check out, bye. Oh, and then they show up and they hand you a bunch of projects and you're like, no. So if you miss a class, it's not my responsibility to regurgitate the class to you personally again. So when you come up to me, you go, what did I miss? Like, look, I already said it once and you weren't there. So I can give you a little idea of what I said, but I'm not going to regurgitate the whole thing. And you need to go find somebody who's willing to explain what I went on about to you. Okay. That's reasonable. That's your responsibility. All right. So we're going to be in a physical classroom. So, no food or drink, man. If you're sitting back there eating a blimpy, like you are totally distracting me. You are distracting people around you. You're making a mess. You're getting the equipment dirty. No, you may not. Liquids, you may have a secure, and I mean snap, twist, top. If I fall over, not a drop comes out. Container full of liquid. Coffee, whatever. Don't show up with a McDonald's cup with a straw. Don't show up with a coffee cup with a plastic lid and an opening. Those don't count. Those need to be taken outside. If you show up with stuff like that, you know, don't take it personally. I'm just going to say, look, you got to finish that outside. So you can either take it and throw it out, or you can go outside and finish it. Your choice. You're an adult. I'm not mad at you. You just can't have it. Well, I'm a pretty amicable guy. I like to joke around and all these sort of stuff. But I will say that the phone and talking when I'm talking, these next two things are the kind of things that I might seem a little bugged by. Put your phone away. Come on. Can't you put that thing down for a second while someone else is talking? Put it away. I don't want you distracted by it. I don't want you looking at it. You're supposed to be looking and listening to me. You're supposed to be participating in the class. So put your phone away. Also, when I say that, I mean, put your other web pages away, put your email away, put your other software away. If you're in my class and you're doing Pro Tools work, you're not listening to me. You're doing Pro Tools work. Yeah, I am. Just like I listen to TV when I'm working. Oh my God. Please don't do that. But okay, so if you're talking when I'm talking, though, if I'm giving a lecture and you're back there going nur, 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 back to me, I'm gonna walk over to you and go, may I answer a question to you? And I am honestly wanting to see if I can help you, but you are being totally rude to me and interrupting me while I'm talking, and I take exception to that. So that's like one of the one things that I will actually get kind of like, you'll notice I'm like not smiling. So onto my lecture style. Like I said, I'm laughing now. I might not be then, but I'm personally pretty easy going. I got a quick wit and a sense of humor. I love shenanigans. I'm going to joke with you. If I ever say anything to you and you're like, what? Step back and think about what I just said. I might be trying to joke with you in a bad way. Not in a bad way, but in a, you know, sort of way that you don't understand. My apologies for that, but like, that's who I am. Sorry. You know, I'm an artist who's a teacher, not a teacher who's an artist. So there's a little bit of a deficit there as far as my quality as a instructor, because I'm, well, you know, when you look at a lot of the popular culture film teachers, the sensei is always like a drunken monkey or something that's going to slap you on the back of the head. Okay, so I'm not quite that bad, but I will joke around with you and prompt you. I may say something inflammatory to you to kind of get you to look at work or a concept a different way. Not like inflammatory. I don't mean it like I'm going to insult you or something. I mean, that I might go, well, what if, you know, how come you didn't try this or something? So you just got to, you know, sort of roll with that. It's just me being me. And, you know, you can always come and talk to me about that. Frequently, I draw on examples from popular culture to relate the concepts of what I'm talking about to you better, to the greater culture better. So a lot of times I'll say, yeah, this is like that thing you saw in this piece of media. So if you don't know anything about American culture, that might be kind of rough for you because you might be going, what the hell is he talking about? I don't know that movie. I remember teaching visual literacy at University of Tampa in the 2000s and saying something about Indiana Jones. And I remember looking at the class and they all had this blank look on their face. And I'm like, whoa, Indiana Jones, right? And they had no idea what I was talking about. So I may make a reference that you're unfamiliar with, and you need to stop me right then and go, Dog Star Man Stan Breakage, huh? Dog Star Man by Stan Breakage doesn't even have audio. I hope you'll look up Stan Breakage, Dog Star Man now, just for the pure shock and awe. I do this to kind of better demonstrate or give you a better depth of understanding or functionality to the concepts in the course. If you find yourself wondering what I'm talking about, just ask. Breaks. Oh, these classes are 2 hours, and I think they give you a break halfway through. Man, you never worked a 40-hour-a-week job. They don't give you a break every hour. Now, having said that, I don't mind that. However, I never met a class that goes in and out in 10 minutes. So here's what I propose. I propose that during our hour and 50-minute class, where there's a 10-minute break halfway through, we just take that 10 minutes and we put it at the end of our class and make it an hour and 40-minute class. And then you as the student become an adult who will just stand up and walk out the door if they need to use the restroom or get a drink. In that, if there's an emergency, just go do it. Just go. You don't need to ask me. Just get up and go use the restroom or get a drink. But I will say that, you know, you should think of these things beforehand. You know, make sure you go in the bathroom before a 2-hour class and get a drink, whatever you're going to do, get yourself all set to go in and sit for an hour, a little more than an hour and a half. So that's not much longer than a movie. I think you guys should be able to do it. So if anybody has a problem with that, you just need to talk to me about it. But generally speaking, I've never met a class yet that didn't go, oh yeah, 10 minutes early, I'm down. So, you know, if you need to get a drink, but I'm just not going to have this big social whole class moves out and moves back in. That just, it's never 10 minutes. Okay, moving on. You guys got to tell me next class if that's not okay. Oh, you are expected to expand on directed research. If you ask me a question, I don't know it. And you go, well, gosh, Mr. Neville, you don't know it. What are you going to do? And I would say, well, I'm going to do a web search for it. Notice that I did not say Xerox. Back in the old days, if you said, oh, just make a Xerox copy of it, the people at Canon copiers were so pissed off because apparently a Xerox copier has a Canon engine. So when you were saying, just Xerox it back in the 80s and 90s, the people at Canon were just like, and in the same way, if you say Google it, I'm sure DuckDuckGo and all the other web browsers or web search engines are just going, how can we compete with that? Having said that, I think Google has some excellent tools for image creation. Or for image assumption, we'll talk about later. But I don't care how you look up something. You are expected, if you don't know how to do something, you say, I want to do this in this project, but I don't know how. How do I learn to teach myself when Mr. Neville's not around? And that is by self-directed research. So you decide you need to know more about this because you're not really getting it. And you go and you watch videos and you read articles and you go to chat rooms and you do the research. There are no more textbooks anymore. There's no textbooks. I mean, there's a few, but I mean, like, people don't use them. I mean, you got to understand that it's shifted online, so you got to understand what good online research is. Now, when I give you a wiki, you should go, God, Chip, wiki, is that the best you got? Well, it's the best I got in a week and a half of putting this class together, I'll tell you that. But it's also Why not? I mean, honestly, I think back a long time ago, Wiki was a little bit shaky, but it's so vetted now that you can pretty much, if you can't rely on the information in Wiki, it tells you that this is unverified or uncorroborated or whatever, however they do it. So when I give you a Wiki link, that's to start. That's to just get you oriented to what it is so that you can go on and find out what's important to you about this concept and what you can draw from these things that I'm laying out for you. Okay, late work. I don't accept late work. Just put that in your mind. I don't accept late work. However, with prior notification and discussion, a student who is really interested in their education, A would have talked to me ahead of time when they weren't understanding it, B wouldn't have waited till the last minute, and C would ask me for help. And if, in the case of the way this course is structured, that help is probably going to come to you by a deadline extension. So be proactive. If you're going to think you're going to be late and you're like, Mr. Neville, I'm just struggling. Can you direct me to some better resources or can you help me in class? Then that is the right thing to do if you think you're going to be late with work. Now, if you forgot, you didn't notify me, you just blew it off and it went by you, don't expect that I'm going to accept that work. Don't. Okay? It's not going to be accepted. Now, work that for whatever negotiation I do with the student is accepted, with a few exceptions, it's going to be 25% reduction in class and in score to turn something in late. It's not a person who turns something in late should not have the same grade as someone who got it on time. They did more work. They understood it better. It's how grades work. So I apologize, but if you want a zero, that's no good. A 75 is much better than a zero, to your average. So work with me on that. Depending on the kinds of problems you have, we can negotiate late work. But you negotiate it. You don't ask for forgiveness afterwards. That is a big NO. Email, check your email daily, especially the 8 a.m. class, because I will be coming from Seminole, Florida. I'm here in my beautiful Seminole, Florida home, my electronic studio where I record audio and do post-production. I am subject to the occasional mechanical problems with a car that everybody is. I'm subject to traffic issues. So if any of those things arise as I commute to Tampa in the morning, I will definitely try and let you know ahead of time, as far ahead of time as I can, but with an 8 a.m. class, there could be an occasion where I just don't get there on time. There's a wreck on the bridge, or there's a mechanical problem with one of my vehicles. I'm in a big family full of people and cars and stuff. So I'll do my best to notify the class if I'm able to make the drive. If you're coming in from somewhere, just check your email before you leave. If you're a student in your dorm room, check your email before you walk over there. It might, I don't know. Seems prudent. Ask me anything. I'm a digital media teacher through and through. I know stuff that I've forgotten more stuff than most people know. So, I love and expect rigorous inquiries about this course and others. Clearly, I have an issue with the Adobe suite of products, but I got direction, if not direct answers for you. And that's true. Like if you're having trouble with After Effects or Premiere or Pro Tools or so many kinds of software, and you ask me, you'll find I have a pretty good answer for you. A lot of times, not for everything, but if I don't have the direct answer out of my mouth, I have some place where I know you can get an answer. All right, that's my classroom policies, and that covers the introduction of Unit 1.